Hello, students of Dynamics. This is Dr. Dan Baker, and today we're going to introduce a new chapter. Here we are in the second half of Dynamics, getting started with rigid bodies. Okay, so as we talk about rigid bodies, realize what we're referring to here are fundamentally a solid body which does not deform. Okay, so we can still think, just like in statics, that we are building and we are working with, I like to joke about it, calling rigid bodium, completely indestructible, non-deformable, the most amazing substance on Earth. But as compared to particles, it now has mass spread out over a certain amount of area. Okay, and so that's going to be one of the main things. Not only its mass is spread out, but also its velocity is going to be spread out in a sense where you can have different velocities at the different points on the same body. Whereas with particles, we always assumed that either all the forces were concurrent or all the mass was in one location, or essentially all we had to worry about was the velocity and acceleration of the centroid of one of those bodies. But now we're going to have to deal with velocities and accelerations of multiple points on a body. Okay, so we are back into a motion chapter. So realize also that we're going to repeat the same topics. We're going to talk about motion of rigid bodies. We're going to talk about Newtonian kinetics of rigid bodies, work energy of rigid bodies, impulse momentum of rigid bodies. And that's going to be it for dynamics. Okay, so basically a repeat of the same topics that we had for particles, now with rigid bodies. So motion we can split out into two different forms. We have translation, and we also have rotation. Terms related to translation are things like linear velocity, linear acceleration, linear position, right? V, A, R. Rotational terms, and I'll do the analogous ones right below here. Angular velocity, which is also a vector. Angular acceleration, which is a vector. Angular position, which is a vector. Okay, so we have analogous terms in both for both rotation as well as translation. Noting the units of all these terms are different. All of the angular terms are measured typically in radians per, so, you know, angle is just pure radians or degrees. Omega is radians per second. Alpha is radians per second squared. And then all of the linear terms, of course, are going to use feet or meters. Okay, so there's differences between translation and rotation. Every time that you see a term in dynamics, I think it's worthwhile to practice thinking, is that a rotational term or is that a translational term? Okay, because I see a lot of students getting them kind of blurred. And so make sure that you separate those out. So if we take a look at both translation and rotation, and we think about more and more complicated types of motion, it turns out we have four different kinds of motion. Okay, so the first type we're going to call rectilinear translation. So rectilinear, meaning that it is in a straight line. Okay, so if I have a rigid body, and if I know the velocity of one point on this body, call this point A, so this would be VA, down here is going to be VB. If it is in rectilinear translation, it is fundamentally moving in a straight line. And every single point on that body has exactly the same velocity. This is actually the case we dealt with most in the first half of this class, right? When we treated something as a particle, we assumed that every point on that body had the exact same velocity. So to write this out in words, we can say that velocity vectors are equal at every point. So when I say equal, Equal here is referring to that they are parallel. And they also have the same magnitude. Because keep in mind that every single vector is made up of both a magnitude as well as a direction. So if we say a vector is equal to another vector, both of those things have to be paired up. So some equations that we could write relating the velocity and a few other things. I'll put those over here on the right. We can write that v1 as a vector is equal to v2 as a vector. Doesn't matter what snapshot in time, that will always be true. What about the angular velocity omega? What do you think is the angular velocity of a body in curvilinear translation? Now we're just getting to know omega. We'll get to know it better and better. But do you think that a body in translation has any angular velocity? Turns out that it does not have an angular velocity, because angular velocity is the time rate of change of angular position, and the angular position isn't changing for something in translation. We also could find that our a sub n, right, which is an acceleration of a point on a body towards the center of curvature. Now, let me change the color here. I do like to keep my velocities in brown, my accelerations in purple, to keep things kind of consistent. And so if this body is not moving in a curved path, it cannot have a normal acceleration. Okay, so that's just kind of some introspection there on rectilinear translation. Next kind of motion we have is also translation, but this is going to be number 2. This is going to be curvilinear translation. So in curvilinear translation, if we start out with our rigid body being vertical, it needs to stay vertical, but it can actually move along a curved path. Okay, so if we have this upper point up here, point A, let's draw a little path diagram. Here's B. This path is going to be parallel at every single point in time. So essentially our beam could move from location 1 to location 2. Now we know the velocity is always going to be perpendicular to the path, and so this would be VA1, this here would be VA2, still tangential to the path here, VA2, VB2. Oh, I see I mislabeled this one right down here. This lower one here being point B, this should have been VB1. At time 1, but at location B. So we can see here that the velocity vectors are equal at every point but they change direction over time. Okay, so at any instant, the velocity vectors are going to be parallel on that body. They're not only going to be parallel, but they're also going to have an equal magnitude. So we still could say here that my VA1 as a vector is equal to VB1 as a vector. Also VA2 as a vector is equal to VB2 as a vector. Okay, so at those two different times, they are still equal. So what about omega with this body? What is the time rate of change of the angular position? Well, it turns out the angular position is not changing, and so we still have a zero value. What about the normal acceleration? We said that normal acceleration is needed anytime something moves in a curve. We can see that we have a curved path in this case, and so we end up with an AN. I'll just write this instead of equal to, we'll just say is greater than 0. Okay, it's a non-zero value. So those are both translation motion. Next, we get into our first type of rotation, and it's pure rotation. We call this fixed axis rotation. And in fixed axis rotation, we're going to look at this same beam shape. It's just that it's going this time to rotate around a fixed point. And so rotating around a fixed point at some later time, it's still going to be rotating around that point. And what we can see here is that if we find out the velocity, say, of this endpoint, let's call this now VA. I'm going to move my point B here to the middle. And what we'll see is that the distance from the fixed axes dictates the amount of linear velocity. Okay, so we can say that linear velocity increases as a linear function of the distance from the fixed axis point. In this case, we'll call this fixed axis point 0. And we'd see this same thing later. So if I had these same two points, my velocities will still remain perpendicular to this line. And often what we do with this is we indicate it with a position vector, okay? Starting at our fixed axis point, ending at the point of interest. And again here, just to sketch this out, we have proportional velocities, okay? So VA sub 2, VB sub 2. And so we can draw on here that we have our angular velocity, omega. In this case, it would be negative from the right-hand rule. And every single one of these linear velocities is perpendicular to that R vector. And they're perpendicular. We'll talk more about this in the chapter. But they're perpendicular because we have a cross product, which is V is equal to omega crossed with R. I introduced this cross product a little bit back in the angular momentum chapter. Okay, so this is fixed axes rotation. And you could think that the angular displacement of this body is exactly the same for all points. And so we can say the angular displacement, which is theta, is the same for all points. And we can also say that the linear velocity V increases as a function of R, our position vector. Okay, so those two points to make about fixed axes rotation. Now, one other thing that's quite interesting about fixed axis rotation is that our angular velocity is now a body property. It doesn't matter if you talk about the angular velocity of point A, point B, point O, right, which is actually the fixed axis point, all of those would be exactly the same value. So omegas are for bodies. So write that over here. So omega is a body property. So where linear velocity, linear acceleration vary by their location on a body. Okay, it's more, you can think that the linear terms are a point property. All of your angular terms, omega, alpha, and theta, are a body property. So that's another contrast between those two. And then I also highlighted here just this idea that the velocities are perpendicular to that position vector. A linear position vector starts at the fixed axes point. So the last type of motion combines both rotation and translation. We call this general plane motion. And so in general plane motion, maybe we started with the beam sitting up here, and maybe it ended up in its final location, say here. If these are our same two points, let's map these, noting this is certainly not the only kind of general plane motion, but this would be one example. Let's say that this one started this way and then swung up here. So we can see with these velocities, they are not parallel. Turns out they are typically not equal in magnitude either. Okay, so we end up, and label these again, VA1, VB1, VA2, VB2. Okay, so general plane motion is fundamentally the combination of both translation plus rotation. Our velocity vectors are no longer parallel. They're also not equal in magnitude. It turns out we spend probably 70 or 80% of our time in chapter 16 on this topic. Okay, general plane motion is kind of the star of the show. Once you get your head around fixed axis rotation, which is in section 16.3, basically from 16.5 through 16.8, which is really kind of the heart of chapter 16, it's all general plane motion type problems. So that should give you a little bit of a preview of the different kinds of motion, noting that you can actually interpret the kind of motion by knowing something about the velocity of points on the body. If you know that these velocities are parallel and equal, so parallel direction, equal magnitude, you know that is in rectilinear translation. If you know that they are parallel at an instant, and then their change in direction, and while maintaining equal magnitude at an instant, you can decide that it's in curvilinear translation. In fixed axis rotation, we have that they're still parallel. It's just that they are linearly decreasing as we get closer to the center of rotation. Let me put a little note down here that here at zero, we could say that V0 is equal to zero. There is no linear velocity at zero, but there still is an angular velocity, right? Because angular velocity omega is a body property. And then in general plane motion, it turns out that we're actually, like, we're physically and computationally going to combine the aspects of translation and rotation to describe the general plane motion. Hope this gives you a solid introduction to our rigid body motion, and hope you're having an awesome day.